All right, we have a speaker by the name of Minister Leigh Burton. She is the wife of Deacon and Uncle Bill. Deacon Bill Jr. They have four children and a lovely grandchild. There she goes. This is a great woman of God. I know in some of my dealings with her, when I was going through a little situation, she brought a great deal of joy my way when I was in the depressed stage of my walk or whatever. But not only is she a good friend, but she's a great second mother to me. So I'm pretty sure with some of you all as well, who all call her Mama Lee. So without further ado, I bring you Minister Leigh Burton. Let's greet her with a Bethel number two love. Let's stand up and greet our speaker with a hearty praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord!
Praise the Lord! Mr. Leigh Burton.
You can all bow your heads with me in prayer. Lord, I thank you for your goodness, your grace, and your mercy this day. Mighty God, I'm asking, Lord Jesus, that you bless the service on tonight. Lord Jesus, Lord, that your people receive back that they need. Lord Jesus, continue on, Lord Jesus, through this week, Lord Jesus. I'm asking that you bless each and every one of us, Almighty God. Oh, Lord, as we take heed, Lord Jesus, to the words that's coming across this pulpit this day, Mighty God. Oh, Lord, that we may receive them, Lord Jesus, and apply them to our life, Lord, in the way that you see fit, Mighty God. Lord, I'm asking that you bless the vessel being used, Lord Jesus. Oh, Lord Jesus, that, Lord Jesus, she allow you to be used in the way that you see fit, Lord, not in the way that she feel it should go, Mighty God. Lord, I'm asking that you remove Lee, Lord Jesus, and place solely you inside, Mighty God. Oh, Lord Jesus, that your people receive, Lord, all that you have for them, Lord. I thank you this day, Lord Jesus. I thank you for your mercy and your grace. Oh, Lord, I'm asking that you continue to bless us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm like past nervous. Past nervous, I'm shaking. So just continue to keep me in prayer as I try to go through this and try to get this done in the way that the Lord has for me to do it. The song was creating me a clean heart of love. And the reason why I chose that song, because it goes with our theme. We're creating a clean heart, and that the Lord may renew that right spirit within us. So that was a fitting song for this particular occasion. And I'm thankful that the Lord gave it to me to be able to sing, you know, and for us to just take heed to some of the messages that, I'm sorry, I gotta take my glasses off. Just take heed to the message in the song, to let us know that in everything that we do, even if we stray away, or even if we feel like we're not doing it 100%, that the Lord can restore it back to you. I mean, he can restore you back to him and give you that walk that you so desire and give you what you need to make this journey. Now, I'm coming out of, I'm using the text that's our theme text as well, coming out of Psalms 51 and verse 10. And I really, really wanted to say that if you missed this morning, everything that she said this morning was in my heart to say it the way that she said it. Amen. But I'm not her. So it won't come out that way. So if you missed it this morning, you missed a treat. But the message is still the same. It's the same message that's being taught over and over and over again. Same messages that Pastor Hill has, ironically enough, been teaching this past week for the women on our role and the way that we can be blessed above measure. The scripture text is Psalms 51 and verse 10. Putting glasses back on. And I'm reading to verse 12. And it says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not that Holy Spirit from me. restoring unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. I'm also going to read the other scripture that she called this morning, which is in Proverbs, because we are dealing with the women. Proverbs 31, and we're going to read verse 10, of course. And that scripture says, who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. The other scripture I want to end with is Proverbs 31 and verses 30 and 31. I'm not reading it out of the King James Version, although, well, I better read it out of the King James Version first. And it says, favor is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman that feareth the Lord shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. I have an Amplified Bible, and I really love this Bible because it gives you definition of what the King James is saying without changing the meaning of what the King James is saying. So in that it says, charm and grace are deceptive, and beauty is vain, which is, it's not gonna last. But a woman who reverence and worshipful fears the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. Let your works be seen, and they will praise you in the gates for the work that you do. You don't have to. If you're doing what is called for a woman to do, and if you're doing what is called for a spiritual woman to do, the praises are going to be just flowing in. Because like the preacher said yet again this morning, because she was all in my message, the saints see us all as saved, because we're all together. But what about those people on your job? How do they see you? What about your family members that are not in the church? How do they see you? When you're walking down the street and somebody just say good morning, what is their perception of you? Because even in a good morning can draw somebody or make their day and make them wonder, why did they speak to me that way? You know, but if we're doing what the Lord is calling for us to do as women in Christ, our praise, He's going to give us that praise. He's going to make it be known and let it be seen among so many others outside of here.
That's right.
When we talk about the praise, it's like your kids. You got kids and you go to school and they say, oh, your kid is the best kid in the class. I just love to see them every day. Oh, they do this. Oh, they do that. Oh, I'm just so glad to have them. That's a praise.
That's right.
Their praise is being shown and letting it be known. So when you see other people coming here like, yeah, I know Sister So-and-so, she invited me. And boy, I just love her spirit. You know, those are the praises being shown in the gates.
That's right.
But the subtitle to our Women's Week is Women, Check Your Attitude. I love that title, I'm sorry. I love it because I have a checklist on the things that I should be doing from the time I got into church to right now, and of course I got more to learn and more to do. And I'm sitting downstairs and I'm like, Lord, how am I supposed to do this? Because like I said again, she preached everything that I wanted to say. But the Lord let me know something. Oh, we got a whole lot more to say. Maybe not in the way that she did it. And the way that I know to do it is sort of in a teaching method. Okay? So I was sitting down there, and the steps to becoming a woman.
All right.
You know, we have from the age zero, when they first born, up until we die. But there are phases in each woman's life that we have to adhere to. We got 0 to 5, and we know that 0 to 5 is the baby stage. So we treat you as a baby, and you're going to act like a baby. But then we got the 5 to 10-year-olds. That's a child. So you start to stop doing your baby things and start behaving as a child. You know right from wrong. We don't have to tell you right from wrong because you know what's expected and you know what's not expected. So now you're coming up, and as you get into the adolescent age, that 11 to 18 years, you know, that's a big gap. That's a lot of age. But yet you know what you're supposed to be doing. But in your, the way that you feel about you, it's where I want to be me. I don't want to be the shadow of my mama. I don't want to be the shadow of my daddy. I want to be me. I want people to see me for who I am. Yes. So we start doing things to try to make people see me, not mama, not daddy. And sometimes that takes us that long, hard-headed route, yes, where you keep getting, yes, your tail beat, yes, you keep getting put on lockdown, on punishment, you keep being told, now you know you ain't supposed to do that. Now you know you ain't supposed to do that. Now you know, but you come out of it. You hit 19 to 30, you know, between that age group. Now you're a young woman. So now you've proven yourself as a young woman. I'm grown. I know what them kids went through. I know how they acted. I've been there, done that. I'm grown. Some of them like to say another word, but y'all ain't made it to that other word yet. Okay, believe it or not, at 19 to 30, you still learning. You still learning how to be a woman. You're still learning how your body works.
Yes.
You're still learning your mood swings. You're still learning why I got this attitude the way I have it.
That's right.
Because at the adolescence, you ain't understanding why it's getting on my nerves so much. You know it. But when you get 30, you're like, oh, light bulb. I understand that part, but then we got the 30 to 50 year olds. Well, yeah, we're coming out of the young woman stage, and some of us are mothers. And we're now raising those kids that we once were, and knowing the way that they shouldn't be. And this is where our senior mothers come in. Because now we're starting to realize that everything that they was telling us when we was 19 to 30 is actually true. Like, man, if I hadn't listened then, maybe my road wouldn't be so hard right now. And then we get our senior mothers, which is 50 and up. You know, we can really call them women because they have earned that title.
Yes.
They have experienced things that we have yet to experience. They have done things that we have yet to do. They have so much to share and give, but for some reason, we don't get it until we between 30 and 50.
Well,
I'm trying to push the cycle back, at least to the 19 to 30 year olds. Start taking heed,
yes,
to what the mothers are telling you.
That's
because
right.
They're telling you for your good. They're not telling you to drive you up the wall. They're not telling you because they think that they're always right. In raising of your children, they already been there, done that. They're grandparents now. And their grandkids are not newborns like mine. Their grandkids are kids in that second phase of life. Okay, so these senior mothers, these older mothers, they have a lot to give us, but we got to be willing to receive it.
Amen.
But if we want to create in us that clean heart, if we want to check our attitudes and get ourselves where the Lord wants us to be, we need to start paying attention to those that are with us still.
Yes.
They have a lot to give us. Don't look at how long they've been here. Because even though they just got here, they still got some things that they can tell you about out there. Because they was out there and just got in here. So they can tell you at their age what life is. As I'm sitting down there, and I'm thankful for the Lord, and I'm thankful that I got the opportunity to come in Bible class, but Pastor Hill was hitting on us so hard, I thought it was a little unfair, some things I wanted to raise my hand up on. But I know that what he's saying is true. And because this is our week, it's good that he's on the women this week. You know, because what he's saying is true. Us guiding the home is a big thing.
Yes, it is.
If you marry, if you have kids, us guiding that home, it's the biggest responsibility that we have.
Absolutely.
First charge.
First, you're right. First charge. So if we're not guiding our home, don't you know we're being disobedient?
That's right.
You're thinking that, I'm coming to church every Sunday. Uh-huh. I'm here on Bible class. But what is your home life like? Uh-huh. Now, your husband might not be the husband that say, I want dinner on the table at 5 o'clock and it better be done. He might be the husband that'll take hot dogs instead of steak. Uh-huh.
That's right.
Which would be great. Okay? But are you even throwing out the hot dogs? Are you even giving them the choice? You know, and this is a small thing. We home all day. Well, I'm not anymore. But I'm home. When you're home.
That's right.
It should not never be a need for your house to be dirty. I'm sorry.
That's right.
It should never be.
You preaching.
And saying that, I got little kids is just not an acceptable excuse. Learn your kids. Learn their patterns. Learn how to handle these different situations. You know when they go take their nap. You know when it's time for them to take a nap. Clean up then.
Come on.
That's a suggestion. I'm just trying to get us to start being more aware and more in tune with what we're supposed to be doing as women in God. We're now at a stage where a lot of us did not take heed to the mothers when they were trying to tell us this before. And now we got a second opportunity. The Lord is bringing it right back in your lap. He's telling you just what you need to do. You know, I got... I got a lot going on in my head, so it's like a lot that I want to hear.
Amen.
But I got to stay alone in the lines of what he gave me to hear. You know, and I'm just looking at, we sit up here and we, as young women, and I'm now looking at the ages of 11 and 18, and y'all looking at saying, I'm not really going that route. I'm not really caring about what's going to happen. I'm not married. I don't have to adhere to these things. I don't have to do these things. But you're going to come to that age where you're going to want to do some of these things. And you're going to be at that age where you're going to be married and that you're going to have a life outside of your parents' home. If you never get married, you still got a life outside of your parents' home.
That's right.
You don't plan on staying there until you're grown, old, dead, and gone.
Right.
Because it's just not going to happen. But also dealing with in what the Lord is dealing with me on doing, and everything that we do, the Lord is going to bless us as we do it. Guiding our home, raising our children is the first priority of a married mother, woman with kids. That's our first priority.
That's right.
If we do that, the Lord will just bless everything else to fall in line. And, you know, we sit and say, well, I don't get to study like everybody else gets to study. But the Lord will give you that time.
Yes,
I've been there, so I can vouch for that. I know he will give you that time. You can't, you know, you say, well, I can't hang out as late as all the other sisters hang out. Been there. But your time will come where you're able to do that. But if you guide your home in the way that it's supposed to go, when you get to that time, you have no worries.
You
have no fears about how they're going to behave while I'm outside of my house.
Thank you,
where they at and what they doing.
That's right.
Because you know where they at. If they like mines, they either work at the Reds or at a school function. So I got my time to do my studying. I got my time to do my praying. I have my time to do what I need to do now to get closer to the Lord.
All right.
But for the young ladies that don't have kids, take this time now.
Yes. That's right. Yes.
Take it now. Take advantage of it. Use it well. Anytime you can come down here and be on the altar to pray. Be on the altar to pray because it's going to strengthen you.
Yes.
It's going to help you to fight against the sins and those things that's coming up against you as a single individual. And it's a lot of things that come up against our single women.
Amen.
That we don't talk about. We don't bring out to the forefront because, you know, you single, you don't have no worries. But you have a lot of worries.
Yes.
You know, flesh is a powerful thing.
Yes.
And like myself, a fornicator made it even harder.
Yes.
A drunkard made it even harder. I ain't have to answer to nobody. I ain't have to cover my breath coming into my own apartment at night. It's just me. I didn't have to worry about nobody seeing how I look. so I can drink all I want and come in here on Sunday smiling and saying I'm having a high time in the Lord. But if you come and start giving yourself more and more to the Lord, those temptations will start to dwindle.
All right, now.
The desire will subside. I won't say it's going away completely, because sometimes flesh like to stir it back up again. But you'll have the strength to fight it. You'll be able to stand against it. You'll be able to say, oh, no, that's just not me right now. I don't need it and don't want it. Throughout this week, and I pray that the Lord bless and give us more and more of what we need to be doing as young women. I pray that He give us what we need to be doing as children of God.
Yes.
You know, I want to so bad to be able to snatch this mic and run around. Yeah, it will not happen. Because it's not me. It's for me to tell you that we can keep doing this thing.
That's right.
It's for me to tell you that our hope is not lost. When you feel like you can't make this journey, single or married, you have a tool that you can call on at any time. All you have to do, and sometimes a lot of people say, well, I can't pray. I can't pray on the job. Oh, yes, you can.
Oh, yes.
I'm a collections rep, so I'm on the phone constantly. But yeah, when they get me stressed, I know how to say, Lord, you got to deliver me. That's a prayer.
Yes.
That's like a war cry. You calling them right now. Ain't nobody else heard me say that but the Lord. Lord, you got to deliver me. They about to make me lose my mind up in here. Right.
I'm sorry.
But I am.
Yes.
I'm tempted to get up and walk away. But yet I got to continue to be that example outside of here of what a holy life should be.
Amen.
I got to continue to show them that everybody else around me is stressed, but Leigh, Miss Leigh is what they call me down there. Why she ain't upset? Our hours got cut. Why Miss Leigh ain't upset? She got 4 kids at home. I was a little ecstatic. That means I can be here more. You know, but they didn't understand that. Why Miss Leigh upset when they changed all the managers around? And you know, they come and sit at my desk and they look at me and they be like, did you hear about what happened to so-and-so? And I sat and said, nope, don't have a clue. Because this is my area of work. So this is all that I'm involved in. But they see that the gossip train stops at Miss Leigh. So now it goes over Miss Lee's head. They'll stand up and say, oh, I'm sorry, Miss Leigh. Because they know what I stand for. I don't say, oh, it's okay for you to cuss around me.
Right.
Because it's not okay. I don't say it's okay for you to tell those foul jokes. Because it's not okay. You know, I'm not going to give you an excuse to disrespect me.
That's right.
Because if I stood up and said, hallelujah, y'all going to look at me and say, oh, she out of order. If I stood up and said, thank you, Jesus,
that's right,
they're going to say, oh, no, she ain't bringing that religion up in here. This is not the place for that religion. But it's not the place for your cussing around me either.
Right.
And I want it to be known. Because I took my checklist out. And I said, have I gotten past the cussing? Have I gotten past the dirty jokes? Have I gotten past the rumors? And as I get past these things, I check it off. And when they come back and I feel like I want to get involved, I say, yeah, I done moved on to that. I got this one that I got to get over now. Ladies, get your checklist so you can check yourself. So you can make sure that you're following in the order that the Lord is calling for you to be in. So that when He calls you to do, you're ready to get it done. Regardless of how big or how small it is, you're ready to get it done. Emotions are set aside. Feelings are set aside because you're called to do the work. And that's what she was saying this morning to us. We're called to do a work. And the Lord has talked to so many of us and told us what our work is. But we're still sitting because we're scared that, well, they're going to look at me like this.
Yes.
Or they're going to treat me like that. wait a minute, my checklist, I done got past the backbiting, I done got past the rumors, I done got past how people feel about me. I don't care anymore. Uh-huh. It's about doing the work of the Lord.
Yes.
It's about standing up and saying, Lord, whatever you tell me to do, I'm going to do it. Create in me that clean heart so that I can do your will, so that I can do the work that you have placed in my charge. Not worrying about what everybody else is wanting to do. Not worrying about how everybody else feels it needs to be done. But I'm getting it done, Lord.
Yes.
If nobody else is going to do it, you told me to do it. Amen. Like she said, you know, of course we got to order. But even when the Lord gives you something, just wait. Keep working.
That's
keep
right.
praying.
That's
keep
right.
studying.
That's
because right. when Pastor Hill come out the door and say, I need for you to get up and preach this Sunday morning, you're like, but I ain't got nothing. But you done studied, you done prayed, you done read, you done had yourself ready at all times. So it's not about your experience in being up here. It's about your willingness to do the work that the Lord has called for you to do.
All right now.
And if you let the Lord take over from there, you're going to do it. But the main thing is you got to study. Because you can't be up here giving a word that don't know what the word is saying.
That's right.
That would be bad.
And we have a tendency of saying, well, I can get up here and I can sing you happy. And there's so many that can sing you so
Watch
happy.
Watch
but what did they say in the message?
Well.
Did you hear the message that they brought forth? What can you pull from it? If you can't pull from it, then that message really wasn't a message.
Amen.
It was just a good feeling time.
Mm-hmm.
But we have so many that come up to do that.
Mm-hmm.
We got so many that want to tell you what God got for you and how God is going to bring you out. But you should already know that.
Amen.
If you study it, if you're praying, if you leaning on the Lord solely, you already know what God got for you.
Right.
Nobody should have to tell you and it be a surprise.
Right.
It should be a confirmation.
That's right.
Amen. Thank you. The Lord told me that last week. I remember it when I was on my knees. I remember it when I was just right there. We was 4 days, nothing but confirmation.
Right.
It should be, oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, Lord, bless me in it. No, we already know what we called to do. Let's get there.
Yes.
Let's start doing this work as women in God. Getting ourselves ready to present God's word, doing what he's calling for us to do, regardless of what everybody else is thinking or feeling.
All right.
You know, I...
Let you go
in. Thank you, Jesus. That song is just ringing in my head so, so strong. Just, Lord, creating me a clean heart. And I know that most of the message was to our sister, but then every time a message comes over the pulpit, it's to everybody in the congregation,
That's
plus
right.
the speaker. So I hope that you got something out of the message.
Amen.
I'm hoping that you can take heed and know that even though we're calling for the sisters to step up and do the work that the Lord is calling for us to do, that the brothers need to be stepping up and doing the same.
Amen.
Stop the name gaming, name claiming, and name pointing. And say who's not doing, but be ready to step up and do the charge.
Yes.
Be ready. This is where we're at now. We're past that baby stage. We don't have those many 0 to 5s in here.
Amen.
We don't have those many 11. What's my other age? No, those little kids. We don't have the kids no more. The 5 to 10 year olds. We don't have that age no more. It's very, very few and in between. And when I'm talking about the age, I'm not talking about the literal little children right now. I'm talking about the how long you've been in here. We don't have those many 0 to 5 year olds that's still needing to be hand fed, that's still needing to be their hand held and walk through things. We have so many adolescents and so many young adults in here that we should be further along than where we're at. But we want to hang on to our childhood. We want to hold on and say, boy, but I remember when we used to be able to do this. Don't you remember that?
and you don't want to grow. We want to say, well, I remember when Pastor Hill said, and not say it, but the word said.
Go ahead and say that.
We don't want to grow past this. We want to stay here so that we can always say, that's what he said. But, so that means that we're out of fault. Because you know, if mama said, hey, I can do it. But now we're past this. We're past it now. But you want to stay in this situation, and it's time for us seriously, literally, to grow. And this is not just to the adults. This is to every individual that has been here from childbirth on, or from 5 years up. Start seeking the Lord and all that he has for you. Get out from up under that umbrella. Get out from up under your parents' control and start being what God wants you to be. Explore yourself. You know, like I said, with that 11, 18 years, you want to find yourself in God. This is where you start seeking the Lord, where you start asking him, Lord, what am I? Where am I to be? What am I to be doing? How am I supposed to do this? Lord, help me. This is what I want. But Lord, what do you want out of me? Make me what you want me to be. We're in that adolescent stage where we should be asking the Lord what we're supposed to be. How are we supposed to be performing it? Lord, am I supposed to be a teacher? Lord, am I supposed to be a preacher? Maybe I'm just a prayer warrior. Maybe I'm a worshiper.
Go ahead.
You know, Lord, what am I? And in what I am, and what you want me to be, help me to grow. Help me to perfect it. Help me to show it so that your program can continue on. We need to start getting into our young adulthood, where like so many of the young adults, gotta use y'all, are preaching. But it's so many more that should be. But because we're not studying in our adolescence and we're not seeking the Lord, we're missing it. And the Lord is going past so many of us. But it's a big gap between that adolescence, where if he goes over us and we get to 0 to 5, you know how long of a wait that is for them to come up? It should continue to roll, just like your old age, keep going every year. We're supposed to be getting better and better, moving out the way, moving into other things, going to different places, and not worrying about any ball dropping.
Come on.
Not worrying about us missing a beat at all.
You're right.
He shouldn't have to worry about it. He should say, well, because we know how much he loved them ribs. He don't have to worry about anybody not being ready to come up here and teach.
That's right.
A Bible class.
That's right.
We should be able to walk in and the hands should go up. You need me to teach. Why don't we have a question and answer session to see what we all know?
Exactly.
We can't get there if we ain't nowhere near it. Because we're not studying.
Well.
So when the teacher gets up, if he's out of his presence, half of us are not here. Pastor Hill's not here, so we can't say Pastor Hill said. And we don't want to say what somebody else said because they ain't right. But we need to start growing. That's that adolescence. You know, they feel like that. Parents are never right. You know, somebody else know more than the parent. Let's get into our young adulthood. Let's get into that 30 to 50 stage where we're becoming adults. And when we get 50, then we grown. They can literally say they grown. We still learning. Now, don't get me wrong, we got some 50s in here and it's still growing.
That's right.
But in the sense of saying, if you're 50, you have lived quite a bit more than what we've lived. And even though you might be immature and you're 50, you still have done more than what we've done. So if you're 50 and you still acting 30, you might want to check yourself. Because you should be able to teach somebody something now. I can't teach Lady Yolanda how to be saved over 20 years
because I haven't made it to that yet. I'm just at 20. So she has a whole lot more to teach me than what I can teach her. But I can teach that one right there. Yep, got it. It's gone. And I can teach some of the younger people on some of the things that I've done from in my 20 year span of being saved. Dealing with my kids, dealing with my spouse, dealing with my unsaved family, dealing with a lot of different things. That I can show you. I can share my experience. You know, you might not be able to do it 100% the way I did it, but I can share the experience. I can say, I know where you're at. I know how you can get out of it. But I hate to tell you, mine's just gonna be through prayer. It's a powerful thing. It will knock a person down, and it will help to strengthen the home. It will put kids in order. It will make spouses a little bit more humble in how to deal with you. Because all you're going, like Pastor Hill said, you're going over, but he's telling the truth on this. You're going over his head. If your spouse is out of line, go over his head. And you tell him, look, you see what he's doing. You see what he's not letting me do. I'm a witness, it works.
Yes.
I know that it will work. A few years, like 10, 15 years ago, I messed up my Achilles. The reason why my Achilles got messed up is because my husband had some, people in his ear telling him about how his wife should be. And he came home one day, and I don't even know if he remembered this or not. He came home, wrong person. He was like, what you been doing all day? You probably just been sitting on the couch watching TV. Now, one, that's out of character for me. My house is spotless. I clean all day. So I'm like, okay, I let it go. He come home another day, and he tell me, what you been doing? Why you always just sitting on the couch when I get home? But dinner's done. Kids' homework is finished. I'm sitting in there with the boys watching some cartoon. Okay. I said, Lord, you're going to have to work on him. Because I know what I'm doing is what I'm supposed to be doing. My kids have never missed a meal. They have never had dirty clothes on their back. They're not dirty. So why is he coming at me like this? And literally, I'm saying, why is he coming at me like this? So, a week later, my Achilles went out. Somebody stepped right into it, tore it completely in half.
Jesus.
Right, painful. But it wasn't as painful as a lesson for me as it was for him. Because he came back and sat on the bedside and said, honey, I don't know how you do it. So I know the power of prayer.
Yes.
And boy, I got to remember that. I got to keep that in my mind so I won't pray that prayer again because I don't want to be in that much pain. So be careful what you pray and ask the Lord give some stimulation. Don't take me out the picture.
All right.
You got to ask that because you want him to get it done, if you say, Lord, get it done, he going to get it done.
Yes.
But Bill has always been a great help to me. If I'm down and I'm sick, I know that he can take these boys. I ain't never been homesick and my kids not been to church. He took them with him. But then it was due to that lesson learned. He knows that you got to keep your wife in good condition, so to speak. If she's tired, let her rest.
Amen.
You take over for a minute. If she needs a break, send her out. You can watch these kids for a couple of hours. It was a lesson learned, and unfortunately, he learned it the hard way. But it was a lesson learned. And now I don't never have to worry about my wants because I did what the pastor said. I took it over his head. But while taking it over his head, I was doing what I was supposed to be doing. I took care of my house. I managed my kids.
I managed whatever needed to be done, without question, without wonder. He never had to come home and say, what's for dinner? Unless I told him the night before that we ain't got nothing in the refrigerator and nothing in the freezer and no money to get it with.
All right.
But even in that, the Lord has still made a way.
Yes.
I mean, I remember when all I had was $15 and I had to get food for a week. And I'm like, looking like, Lord, how am I supposed to get this done?
Uh-huh.
I don't have one mouth to feed. I got six.
Yes.
And truthfully, and I'll be truthful, I did not want beans.
Amen.
I didn't want beans.
Amen.
So I didn't ask for beans. I didn't say I would be thankful with beans. I didn't bring the bean situation up in no sort of to say, I don't want beans. I got lunch meat. That was great.
Yes.
I got ramen noodles.
Yes.
Another good one. But I had a meal every night, a full, complete meal because of the way that the Lord had directed me on what to do. And I followed those directions. I mean, it might not have been seconds and thirds. We might not have gotten that, but we got a meal. My kids got up in the morning and they got breakfast and they got sent off to school. Thankfully, they ate lunch. So I'm telling you young women, suggesting to the young men, take heed to what the Lord is telling you to do tonight.
That's right.
For those that are not married, retain it. Because it will save you a lot of heartache if you just follow the directions given.
Yes.
Don't question, don't wonder, don't even second guess. Just follow what the Lord is giving us so that we can do this thing. Amen. So that when you get married, you don't have to learn the lesson that Bill learned. Just keep Bill in mind. Don't have to learn that lesson because I'm going to help my wife.
All right.
I'm going to be there for when 3 o'clock in the morning and the baby is waking up and I got to get up work at 8 o'clock. I'm going to get up because she's tired. She got to deal with the baby all day. So I know I got to be at work at 5 and it's 3 o'clock now. Just take heed to it. Women, make sure that you're checking yourself in everything that you do and what you're doing in your home with your kids, with your spouse, with your everyday routine. Is it lining up with what God is calling for us to do?
Yes.
Your prayer life, your studying, it will fall into place if you're keeping your home in tune to the way the Lord is saying to do it. I'm a witness to it so strong, it will happen. And for you, the singles, make sure that you take your opportunity while you have it. And start, keep your prayer life up, keep your studying up, keep your mind on God. Because it's going to keep you through so many difficult situations. It's going to help you through these hard times that's to come.
Yes.
That you don't know about. And if you decide to get married, you can draw from. And remember these things that have been said. And say, I remember, I don't want to go that route. I think I'm going to listen to what he said there because I'm looking and seeing that it didn't work out too well for some other people when they didn't do it that way. Make your life easy in the Lord. Just go with the flow of it and be obedient to what he has to say, tell you to do. It'll make life so much better. And don't forget, ladies, what should we be doing? Checking what? Our attitudes, that's all I have.
Amen.
And I'm just going to tell the message, if there be anyone that is not saved, that want to get to know the Lord and all of his glory and all that he's able to do, if you would like prayer at this time, you can come up.
Create in me a clean heart of love. Renew a right spirit within me. Forgive me of all of my transgressions. Restore your joy in me. Create in me a clean heart of love. my spirit within me. Forgive me of all.
Alfonso.
$20 line, $30 line. I ain't gonna tell you if you put an offering, God's gonna bless you, because if you don't know that, you need to. Lord have mercy. Ooh, the Lord is a keeper of the tongue.
Hallelujah.
Amen. You should know that. You should not have sat in this church and not know that giving to God's program and God's people for the work they do won't get you blessed. Now, I know y'all don't know this, but we're in a recession. Because you're still working. You're still eating what you want, for the most part. You're still going out to dinner. You're still going to the movies. You're still riding in your car. Your gas getting low, but you still manage to get where you need to go. You don't know this is a recession. You know what I'm saying? The folk that's really tied down in this recession is unemployed and homeless. God has blessed you. So you're not unemployed and you're not homeless. And you're only struggling because the oil company is greedy. That's right. So I'm begging for Sister Leanne. I don't beg for me. You don't ever have to put no money in for me. I found out God will give me more than you ever will. If you hold out, I like it when you hold out, because then God step up. But I'm going to beg for my sister.
Yes.
She might have to hear me then. But we're going to take up an offer for the speaker. But I love my sister.
Amen.
Did we argue? You bad. Did she tell me almost she don't like me? You bad. Do sometimes I feel like I don't like her? You bad. But that's my sister.
Come on.
And I ain't going to put her behind nobody. You're going to collect this offer. And you're going to do what you wouldn't do. We're going to collect an offering for Sister Leanne. And I'm asking you to put out for her. I'm asking you to put out for her. If you ain't got no money and some money in the bank, write a check. We'll cash it. If you say don't cash it to May 2012, I'll hold it. Circle the date, put an asterisk by it, initial it, highlight it. Highlight it, dog. But give us some money. Now listen, this ain't a church where the preachers come and tickle your fancy bone. So don't look for that in this church today, but it's in the house.
Amen.
I'm telling you, it's in the house.
Amen.
So come to this church to get that good solid word.
Come on.
That thing that's gonna help me. So if all you got is $2, put $2 in. I want you to go for broke today in this offering right here. Everybody should have something they can give to this offering. $1.50, something. Even the kids got money. I give y'all rich money, y'all take it everywhere but here. Everywhere but here. But it's okay. Because God has kept this place afloat. And I'm telling you, he's going to do me right. He's going to do her right. And you're going to be the one missing out. So y'all know I don't usually take this long to take up no money. But I'm begging for my sister tonight. And you should go home after tonight and you should pray. Now, Lord, the people in our church are speaking this week. Give me something to give them. Give me something to give them. Every night that they speak, we need to learn to bless us.
Yes.
And to be a blessing to us. I ain't got no problem with you going down and tell somebody God gonna kill them. Cause they ain't living right, or cause they won't go do this or do that. I ain't got no problem with your anointing on that, but I got a problem with your money anointing. So give me all your anointing. Don't give me the part you want me to have. Give me all of it. So, all right, we're gonna put you in the hands of the ushers and the collectors of money. Amen. Don't be trying to act like you Jesus and come in here and turn over the money, change this tale. All I want to do is to make us one family. All I want to do is make us one family. It's hard to be one family when we really won't do for one another what we can.
Awesome.
Y'all listen to me. In a little bit, people are going to start getting some money in this church.
Yes. Come on.
You're going to need to bring your money to this church. God is not, and I'm not a money preaching pastor. I've never been a money preaching pastor.
Not at all.
But I'm not afraid to beg for my brother or my sister or to put it out there for God.
Amen.
So I'm saying, listen, you people are going to have to start giving when you don't have, in anticipation of what's coming your way. If you're scared, say so. Should have been a store or two out there. I heard one. Amen. It's okay with me if you're scared. Because I don't want to go into battle with you if you're scared.
Not though it's true.
You're going to freeze up and drop your gun and run. I want to know in advance. I want to know in advance. We're going to put you in the hands of the usher. And those that are taking the money.
Please stand.
Thank you.
Listen, people, please go ask the Lord to give you some money to give his service. These people work in this house. Amen. These people work in this house. Someday you're going to work in this house, I hope. But we pray that you will stay and help to build God's program from here. But you want to be a blessing to those that labor in your vineyard. Because if the laborers are strong, they can do more work.
Amen.
Amen. And they should be working for you. Amen.
Amen.
So we thank God for your liberalities, and we pray that you will, amen, continue this week. We got I like it when we got our house. I do. I mean, that's just personal. All right, if there's nothing else. Oh, we got our speaker back. I should get out of the way and let the anointed one.
Amen.
Let the anointed, I like that, anointed one. I know the Bible's right. I'm not going to talk about it. But the Bible says he that finds a wife finds it a good thing. But I'm not going to contend with God. Amen. So we're going to get out the way. The anointed one has arrived. They have made request of the microphone. So I will graciously bow out for minister anointed Leigh Burton.
What can everybody say? I'll put the hand.
Middle of watch.
Swing me in the.
Power rising.
Welcome to another. In Jesus' name. Amen.